pleases us best. 6-4 is the movement that pleases us best. And now we address you as friends to the cause. Performers are modest and write their own laws. Although we are sanguine and clap at the bars, 'tis the part of the hearers to clap their applause. To clap their applause, 'tis the part of the hearers to clap their applause.
As mentioned before, singing schoolmasters often had diverse occupations in addition to composing and teaching. Oliver Holden, the composer of our next song, was a mariner on the USS Dean in 1782. Later, as a carpenter, he moved to Charlestown to help rebuild the boat after the war. I should say ship, right? Then, while working as a shopkeeper, Holden also taught singing schools and published several volumes of hymns and tunes. Among the odes he composed was one for the reception held to honor General George Washington on his third and last visit to Boston. He trained a choir of young men for the occasion, and when Washington passed under the triumphal arch of the old State House, the choir sang the words, "George Washington, the hero is come." Holden published The American Harmony, a book of sacred music, in 1793. It contained mostly original arrangements in 3 and 4 parts and is best known for his tune, Coronation, with its opening words from a well-known hymn, "All Hail the Power of Jesus' Name." The piece we sing today, Ode on Music, is a secular tribute to the inspiration that the muses provide through music. Holden composes a tune that matches the message of the words. The voices represent a variety of instruments, including warbling lutes. Soprano Maria Shira Godzik masterfully expresses this with her solo in the central part of the song.
Go! Go!
turn to a different time period, to a song with a definite American theme. The words we sing are familiar to most people as the words that are on the base of the Statue of Liberty. The writer of those words, the final five lines of a longer sonnet, was Emma Lazarus. She was born to a wealthy family in New York and began writing poetry while also translating German poetry as a teenager. Becoming interested in discovering more of her own Sephardic Jewish heritage, she became a respected Jewish American author by the 1880s who wrote poems, plays, and novels and advocated against the persecution of Jews. After the Russian pogroms, when thousands of Jews were driven to emigrate to America, Ms. Lazarus also became an advocate for training programs so that the penniless immigrants could become self-supporting. It was around this time that a committee was raising funds for the pedestal to support the statue. Lazarus was asked to write a poem commemorating it for a fundraising auction. At first she declined, but with urging from some personal friends on the committee, she finally agreed and wrote The New Colossus. Her poem was popular and helped raise the needed money, but within a few years was forgotten, and it was not used at the dedication of the statue, the mother of exiles in the poem. The bronze plaque engraved with the famous five lines was installed in 1903, 6 years after her death. Now, the song was written by Irving Berlin, who composed the music for our song at around the same time. Well, he was born in Russia around the same time that Lazarus died. And he immigrated to America with his family at the age of five. His only memory of the persecution there was lying by the side of the road watching the house burn. Living in New York, he and his family struggled to support themselves. And at the age of eight, Irving quit school to sell newspapers in the Bowery, where he experienced the music coming from the saloons and restaurants. At this age, he told his mother that he wanted to become a singing waiter. In his teens, uncomfortable that he was not adding enough to his family's income, he left home and moved into a dismal lodging house in the Bowery. His music education began within his family. His father was a cantor. But it was time on the streets, busking and plugging songs, when he learned that singing popular songs was a way to make a meager living. He taught himself to play piano, both improvising and eventually writing his own music. He later collaborated with other songwriters and made connections within the industry. His first hit in 1911 was Alexander's Ragtime Band. When he entered the Army in 1917, he shared this point of view about the country. "We must speak with the sword, not the pen, to show our appreciation to America for opening up her heart and welcoming every immigrant group." He also co-wrote a song promoting the ending of ethnic conflict, "Let's All Be Americans Now." He became well known and successful as a writer of popular songs and reviews, often with patriotic themes. Berlin, an immigrant raised in poverty, was expressing his gratitude for allowing him to become a successful songwriter. This, a song from one of his last shows, Miss Liberty, was written in 1949 and pays homage to Emma Lazarus and to this country. The show was considered disappointing. We, however, find this song to be quite moving.
You
Our next song uses Psalm 23 to create a powerful image of our being in the loving care of the Lord, similar to the way that sheep are cared for by their shepherd. The text is written by Isaac Watts, a well-known hymn writer in England during the early 1700s. Traditionally, the last lines of the psalm are, "Surely goodness and mercy shall follow me all the days of my life, and I will dwell in the house of the Lord forever." Watts' version, however, concludes with a different, more poetic interpretation, "No more a stranger or a guest, but like a child at home." Virgil Thompson, a contemporary American composer, arranged this choral music based on an old Sacred Harp tune called Resignation. The original music was by an unknown composer and first appeared in the 1835 hymn book, Southern Harmony, a collection of church music in the rural South compiled by William Walker. Virgil Thompson, after his discharge from the Army, studied at Harvard, accepted a fellowship to study music in Paris, returned to Cambridge to graduate, and then went back to live in Paris, where he collaborated with other composers, writers, and artists. He again returned to the U.S. at the time of the German invasion, became a respected music critic, and continued to compose music. Virgil Thompson was known for his role in the contemporary development of an American sound in classical music. This melody is disarmingly simple and beautiful.
Bye.
Our next song, by William Billings, is an anthem. Its words are taken from the Bible and are written as prose, not poetry. The source of this song is Psalm 107, verses 23 to 24. It describes a storm that came from the northeast in the Mediterranean Sea that caused the shipwreck of St. Paul on the island of Malta in 60 AD. It is an expressive narrative text that describes the blowing of the stormy winds and the lifting up of the waves musically, in addition to the words. The lower voices dominate at the waves as the waves descend down to the deep. As the sailors are tossed around on deck, the music is written to give a strong sense of reeling and staggering, like a drunken man. This section has caused some to wonder if perhaps Billings was able to vividly share this sensation because of some personal experiences. Next, we feel that the storm has calmed, and finally we share the sailors' excitement as they enter port and are welcomed by family and friends. The song is a strong metaphor that many can use at different points in their lives. This impressive work by William Billings was published in his tune book, The New England Psalm Singer, that was the first publication ever devoted wholly to an American composer. And it was a good example of a new, uniquely American musical style. It began a tradition of musical grassroots choral singing in America, and Billings knew what he had done. He delayed the publication over a year until he could print it on paper made in the colonies. No English imports for Billings. He was an ardent patriot, a self-educated composer, and an unusual character. Billings had a withered arm and one leg shorter than the other. He was blind in one eye and was described as having an uncommon negligence of person. By 1778, however, he led the music at Boston's most fashionable churches.
Please. bringeth the vessel into port.
And he bringeth the vessel into port. And oh, huzzah, huzzah, huzzah.
Their friends assembled on the wharf to welcome them on shore.
And oh, huzzah.
McCurry was a pillar of his Baptist church and his community of Bio, Georgia. In addition to compiling and publishing a tune book, The Social Harp, he was a modest man of Scotch-Irish descent who farmed his own land with the help of 8 slaves, 7 of whom were children. And, in spite of his modest means, he was known for his generosity and his commitment to supporting the community. He maintained a centralized post office for the residents of his town and was known to have an ability to accurately estimate the size of a plot after walking its borders only once. In addition to arranging tunes, McCurry was also a tailor and a quilt designer. Music commentaries of the time, just after the Civil War, referred to McCurry's tune book, The Social Harp, as being full of strange, weird, and yet beautiful melodies in minor scales. Music after the Civil War was transitioning from traditional tunes to more genteel music. McCurry learned this song, Parting Friends, when he was 8 years old from Mrs. Catherine Penn. It is a variant of another Sacred Harp song, The Filament, and also of an old Irish melody, Wayfaring Stranger. There are different ideas about the meaning of this song. Is it about migrating to a new country or leaving one's home and settling during the settling of this country? Or is it about leaving this life? Does it matter? Enjoy the poignant words and the haunting melody.
Traveling through the wilderness, your
this upcoming song is in a very different style from those we usually sing. It's a campaign song, one of two, written by Stephen Foster to support the presidential campaign of James Buchanan in 1856. At first, this seems to be an odd decision made by Foster, given that Frederick Douglass, an ardent abolitionist, complimented him when he wrote My Old Kentucky Home, which we sang at our last concert. Douglass wrote that the song, Kentucky Home, awakens sympathies for the slave, in which anti-slavery principles take root and flourish. In contrast, James Buchanan, a Northern Democrat, was sympathetic with the South and its slaveholders. And he ran on a platform of keeping the nation united and indivisible in the period before the Civil War. Buchanan's view was that secession by slaveholding states was illegal, but that the federal government had no constitutional right to stop it. Buchanan also opposed an act that would have kept slavery out of the newly acquired territories. He supported the fugitive slave law that allowed federal marshals to return escaped slaves found in any state, free or slave, and declared that